والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي الكريم وعلى آل بيته وصحابته ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ثم أما بعد. إن شاء الله as usual, tonight is our weekly seerah for us. Just a reminder that we are talking about this great period of this religion, the religion of Islam, when the Prophet ﷺ was struggling in Mecca to convey the message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him and ordered him to convey it. وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. So we said that the Prophet ﷺ started first privately and then he went in public. Once he went to all the people with the message, so the people of Quraysh were not for sure, were not happy, he started giving him hard time. Not only emotionally, not only verbally, not only physically, it's everything. And that's what we talked about the last three times. Until we reached last week to the point that they are, or they really tried to get rid of him, to kill him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who remembers that hadith? The hadith that in which somebody wanted to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, shaghal. Qul ya Ghuzzi. Okay. So, in my class, the only person can have the phone is the imam. If you have the phone while I'm talking, ya Ghuzzi, anta wa ma'ani, you will be in trouble. Okay, put it in your hand. I'm gonna collect the phones, by the way. I'll do that. Who remember that hadith? Who remember that hadith? Karajaj Zahiri. How do you know Nabi Sassan? Do you know him? Rajaj Zahiri. He tried to kill the Prophet Sassan. You know this hadith that it was a debate between a Sunni imam and a Shia imam, or Shia people. So the imam came, the Sunni imam came to them, they were in their place, and he had his shoes with him. So he put the shoes with them, they said, yani, why are you having the shoes? You know what, some people that may yani, steal that shoes. They told him, no, never happened. No, I know that the Shia'i people at the time of the Prophet, they used to steal the shoes from the masjid. Then they told him there is no Shia at the time of the Prophet. Done deal, khalas. So why were you here then? No, not Imam Ahmad.
The story said that, maybe.
Allah Ahmad, not Allah Ahmad. But anyway, يعني it says, فَأَنَقُولَ لَكُوَحَ الْجَزَائِرِ Algerian guy used to, he wanted to kill the Prophet. Never happened. There was no Jazairi at that time. Okay. So who wanted to kill the Prophet? Hadith is authentic. فَضَّلْ يَحْمَدْ. No. This is from the drum. But it happened. There is something like that in the seerah. But I'm talking about something that I mentioned last week. I started off last week with this hadith. This man, and the hadith is reported on the authority of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. What else you want? And the one who defended the Prophet ﷺ can Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. What else? And the first letter of the name of the guy is Uqbah ibn Ibn Abi Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt. Right? This guy, he looked at the Prophet, he found the Prophet praying next to Al-Ka'bah. So he went in, he went and he tried to, like, he tied the cloth of the Prophet on his neck and he almost got suffocated, until Sayyidina Abi Bakr, or Abu Bakr Siddiq, he came and he saved the Prophet. Anyway, Umar, he did everything to get rid of the Prophet, to kill him, whatever, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supporting him. I concluded last week with saying that it was not only the Prophet. ليس فقط النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وإنما إن أردت أحيانا إن أردت أن تقضي على صاحب دعوة حول مع أتباع. If you wanna يعني put an end for this دعوة خلاص put him aside. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم is protected by his family, right? What's the family of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? What's the name of the family? بنو هاشم. They are protecting him, a big family in Edmonton.
in Mecca. So they can protect him, but there are people who are following him that they don't have somebody to protect them. So let's go to those people and start giving them hard time. So it was not only the Prophet ﷺ, it was lots of the Sahaba, but the Prophet ﷺ as came in the authentic hadith, they went through tough times at that time, at the beginning of the da'wah. ولذلك this is inshallah what we're talking about today. Then Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه يقول أول من أسلم أو أشهر إسلامه سبعة كان أول من أظهر إسلامه سبعة. مين اللي فكر معايا كده ويديني واحد منهم؟ The first people to announce their Islam are the word seven people to announce their Islam. مين؟ First one. Okay, طيب قلنا ايه؟ أول واحد مين؟ You missed the first one, man. You guys missed the first one. Yes, the Prophet ﷺ. So the first one ever is the Prophet ﷺ. So, أول من أظهر إسلامه سبعة. أولا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأبو بكر. وبلال. وعمار بن ياسر وأمه. مين بقى بعد كده أنا نسيت اللي بعده. والمقداد وصهيب. نو احنا بنقول ايه يا عم خلدون؟ اللي طلعوا للناس بره كده قالوا احنا مسلمين. اول سبعه طلع اسلامهم قدام الناس كانوا هؤلاء السبعه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدنا ابو بكر سيدنا بلال سيدنا عمار his mother سيدنا صهيب سيدنا المقداد. نعم المقداد سيدنا المقداد. So those are the first seven people to announce their Islam. طيب look at them with me. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم منع القوم. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was protected by his people. Okay. وأبو بكر منع القوم. سيدنا أبو بكر was protected from a big family. سيدنا أبو بكر he was a rich person and he had a very good position with the people of Mecca. منع القوم too. وأما سائرهم شبع الحصن فأخذهم المشركون وألبسوهم أدرع الحديد وصهروهم في الشمس فما منهم من أحد إلا وقد واتاهم على ما أراد. So excluding or excluding the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and سيدنا أبو بكر and then look at the other five people, they were all touched and they experienced the punishment and the torture from the people of Quraysh. They, you're like, albasuhum adru'a al-had. You know the arm armors, they put in them and they throw them in the fi batha'i Mecca, in the very hot weather of Mecca. Sunny and hot. It's very hot, you cannot resist that. They throw them in the streets. فَمَا مِنْهُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا وَأَتَاهُمْ عَلَى مَا أَرَادُ. All of them, they, you know what, agreed on what they offered them. Disbelieve in Muhammad, ya khi, at the end, you know, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَا. لذلك ربنا سبحانه وتعالى يقول إيه؟ إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَا وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ. So except for somebody who say the word of kufr, unless it's just through force, somebody is forcing him to say it, and that ayah it was sent down about Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir رضي الله عنه. Sayyidina Ammar was like, he went through a very tough time. Imagine that somebody is killing your dad and your mom in front of you. They killed actually his mother and his father in front of him. فسيدنا عبد الله بن مسعود يقول, all of them, they responded positively except one of them. مين بقى out of the five? سيدنا بلال. سيدنا بلال يقول لك ايه؟ هانت عليه نفسه في الله. He didn't pay attention to himself. You know what? I don't care. You wanna kill me? You wanna torture me? You wanna cut me pieces in front of the people? I don't care. فيقول سيدنا عبد الله بن مسعود هانت عليه نفسه في الله وهان على قومه فأخذوه فأعطوه الولدان فجعلوا يطوفون به في شعاب مكة وهو يقول أحد أحد. So they start punishing him. He had himself. You know what? About my this body I don't care about. You know, and then they start. Who was the master of Sayyidina Bilal? Umayyad ibn Amin.
Umayyad ibn Khalaf.
So Umayyad ibn Khalaf, it was said in the seerah that at a certain point, Umayyad ibn Khalaf, out of spending the whole day in the summer, in the sun, punishing or torturing Sayyidina Bilal, it was said to him, or he said himself, I don't know who's punishing who. Who's torturing who? Me torturing Bilal or Bilal is torturing me? Even he went further than that. He said, you know what? I think those abid, those black people, their skin is different. He doesn't feel it. Actually, he felt it, Sayyidina Bilal. But Sayyidina Bilal got it. Remember one of the hadith, if you guys were paying attention in the khutbah, not like Ahmad Najjar who's sleeping today. I know. You're sleeping. You're sleeping at home, that's what I'm saying. So, one of the hadith that we mentioned today, that this man, when he came to the Prophet ﷺ asking him about the best of the amal, أفضل العمل, قال له إيه؟ أول حاجة إيه؟ What's the best of act first ever? The Prophet ﷺ said that. First one is, if you have this, everything is easy. الإيمان بالله. So Sayyidina Bilal got this. No matter what they do to their body, to his body, he didn't pay attention. He didn't care. You know what? Inshallah, I'm okay. Ahad, ahad. They sent the kids, following him, throwing him with stones, and he said, radiallahu anhu, ahad, ahad. That's what I have, yani, what I live with. I live with la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. That's it. That's his life. That's why it's known. If you know, if you say ahad, ahad, everybody knows that Sayyidina Bilal, radiallahu anhu, used to say that when they were punishing him. وقلنا ان سيدنا عمر بن ياسر again who was his master ابو جهل صح ابو جهل his father the father of سيدنا عمر بن ياسر was مولى of ابو جهل and his family so it was embarrassing for ابو جهل to have three people of his موالي slave people to accept Islam, so he took care of them. As I said earlier, he, you know, tried with them in different many ways, and then at the end he killed his father and his mother in front of him. At the end, Sayyidina Amr ibn Yasir, you know, he had to say the word. However, you know, despite the fact that he cried after that, and he was not يعني, happy to say it, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the ayah clearly, من كفر بالله من بعد إيمانه إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. يعني they were in a different situation. That's why there is a greater way. Like Imam, if I'm saying now to you guys, did you أو هقولها بالعربي الأول وبعدين هحاولها ترجمة. يعني هل عندك من الشوق والرغبة إلى أن تكون أحد هؤلاء الرجال من هذه الفترة؟ Do you, yani sometimes you wish that you, did you wish at any period of your life to be one of those people who lived at that time? What's the answer? Yeah, yani to show the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you see the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and to live in that atmosphere. For sure you would say yes. And this is, was said to one of the great Sahaba. And look at the answer. Because, ikhwan, don't ever wish for a trial, for a test. You never know if you're gonna pass or not. It's يعني لا تتمنين أبدا البلاء وإنما اسأل الله عز وجل العافية. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنا عندي الكلام ده it's coming soon ولكن ناخذ الحديث ده let's take this hadith together. فيقول عبد الرحمن بن جبير بن نفير عن أبيه قال جلسنا إلى المقداد بن الأسود يوما فمر به رجل فقال طوبى لهاتين العينين اللتين رأتا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والله لوددنا أن رأينا ما رأيت. So this is one of the تابعين sitting next to one of the صحابة. The صحابي his name is المقداد بن الأسود. A man is passing by, and he looked at Sayyidina al-Miqdad, and he's greeting him. Welcome to those great eyes who saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We hope that we saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like you. Okay, you and I the same. We will think the same. But Sayyidina al-Miqdad answered in a very precise way to that wish. يقول سيدنا المقداد يقول والله لوددنا أن رأينا وأن رأينا ما رأيت وشهدنا ما شهد فاستغضب فجعلت أعجب. So سيدنا المقداد got angry. فعبد الله عبد الرحمن بن جبير بن نفير عن أبيه اللي هو أبوه يقول لك I was surprised. Why did you get angry? The guy is wishing to see the Prophet ﷺ like you. So what made you angry? So Sayyidina al-Miqdad is looking at you that you might not be that man. When you think of it, هؤلاء الصحابة, they've been through a real tough time. It's not you and I when it is a little bit tight. This month is broke with fire, $200 or $100, or you know what, the car is giving me a hard time. Or no, those people were sacrificing their lives, their honor, their dignity in front of the people. Imagine that they bring Sayyidina Bilal and they put him in the middle of the desert, and the people are watching you being tortured. Very embarrassing. So he is sacrificing everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allah ishtara min al-mu'mineena iba anfusahum wa amwalahum bi anna lahum jannah. Those people, they sold themselves to get jannah. فيقول سيدنا المقداد ليه بقى, why he got angry, المقداد بن الأسود. يقول ثم أقبل إليه فقال ما يحمل الرجل على أن يتمنى محضرا غيبه الله عنه لا يدري لو شهده كيف يكون أو كيف كان يكون حاله. بيقول لي بقى بيقول I'm just surprised why people ask for something that if they to witness something that if they witness nobody knows if they gonna take it or not. Don't say you know what I hope that I was in a place of Sayyidina Bilal. Some people they lost the religion because of that. They are not up to that level of iman and stability in their religion. So do not, Sayyidina al-Baghdad يقول Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows better than you, right? And he knows that you're not able to take that, so you came in a different generation. As simple as that. فيقول ثم يقول سيدنا المقداد والله لقد حضر رسول الله صلى الله عليه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أقوام أكبهم الله على مناخرهم في جهنم. Do you guys, don't you know that there were people witnessing the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and their destination is the hellfire, right? They saw the Prophet. You're talking now that I wanted to saw him, to see him صلى الله عليه وسلم. Enough for me just to look at the Prophet. I know. I hope the same, and you hope that everybody hope, but nobody knows with which party you will be if you are in the same situation. There were people like you, human being like you. You know what Umayyah ibn Khalaf, no, Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, he said at the beginning of the da'wah, mean Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, Abu Mean. Utbah, Abu Mean, the father of whom? Sayyidina Hudayfa. Umin Tal. Abu
Jandal.
Abu Jandal. La, Abu Jandal. أبو جندل كان ابن سهيل بن عمرو. لا في واحدة مشهورة أوي بنت عتبة. هند. The wife of أبو سفيان. هذا الرجل he was one of the main people that they have Islam in the beginning. He was so close to accept Islam. And he told the people of Mecca, leave him alone. Leave Muhammad alone. And they never left him. But he he was one of the first people to be killed when? In the battlefield. However, he was one of the always supporting the idea. Just leave him alone. If he gets victorious, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then عِسُّهُ عِسُّهُ. Then if he becomes the prophet of the whole humanity, from where he comes? From Mecca. And he is your man, he is your relative, he is your, yani you're his family. And if he, the people, yani get him over, or they defeated him, خلاص. They did something that you're wishing for. However, out of arrogance, he was one of the first people to be killed from the three people who were killed in Badr, as we will know inshallah. So Sayyidina al-Baghdad is stressing this fact that there were people who saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was right, but they were not guided to that great religion and they didn't get it. So يعني أخذهم الله أكبهم الله على مناخرهم والعياذ بالله في جهنم لم يجيبوه لم يصدقوه والله جل وعلا جزاك الله خير. Allah, I know that you.
It's not tea.
Not for me?
It's not tea.
It's not tea. No water, I need water. Halal, right?
She water.
It's halal water.
لم يجيبوه لم يصدقوه أولا تحمدون الله شوف بقى سيدنا المغدب يقول أولا تحمدون الله إذ أخرجكم لا تعرفون إلا ربكم مصدقون مصدقين لما جاء به نبيكم قد كفيتم البلاء بغيركم يا أخي you should thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى that you are created you are born as a Muslim right you don't know anything but Islam alhamdulillah it's a great نعمة that Allah سبحانه وتعالى creates you as Muslim and he guided you to that and you don't go and you didn't go through any of these trials or tests والله لقد بعث الله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على اشد حال anyway فالشاهد من كلام سيدنا البغداد انه طلب من الرجل ان يحمد الله عز وجل فانه كان في اول الاسلام من الناس من راى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشهده ومع ذلك لم يتبعه so the point of this hadith is that يا اخي in your situation you are weak about those great Sahaba, the hard time that they went through, but never ever wish to go through the same that they went through because you never know if you're gonna pass or not. Allahu a'lam. طيب. سيدنا خباب برضو دي من ضمن التأكيد على نفس هذا الحديث. It's confirming that fact that you're talking about special people. حتى إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم was hard on giving them the advice after this. Not يعني you know what خلاص يا أخي أنت you can't take it خلاص leave Islam. No, nothing like that. He knew صلى الله عليه وسلم that they are men and they will pass and they will get over it. So he صلى الله عليه وسلم his advice always be stronger, be patient and you will get it. فسيدنا خباب بن الأرض رضي الله عنه يقول شكونا إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو متوسد بردة في ظل الكعبة وقد لقينا من المشركين شدة فقلنا سيدنا خباب came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدنا خباب one of the great Sahaba that to be honest with you he went through a lot ما هو you're talking about those people you know what happened with سيدنا صهيب Rumi when he was migrating from Mecca to Medina. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, when he was migrating, he stood up and said that anybody wants his mom to lose him, meet me behind this, in this valley. Do you know this riwayah? He said that clearly, and I don't care, I'm migrating. But most of the Sahaba, they migrated secretly. One of them was Sayyidina Suhaib ibn Rumi. When he was migrating, they stopped him. We will have this in details inshallah ta'ala. But when they stopped him, the word or the statement that they made was clear. Who are you to leave us with your property? أَتَيْتَنَا سُلُوقًا فَقِيرًا That's how they used to look at those people. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ at this period. And then you came to us very little thing, poor. You know sometimes when somebody when here in North America tells you, you know what? And he looked at you, you know what, you have a degree or you work in a nice job and make money. They look at you, who are you?
as if it's his country. Yeah.
Can go back to your country. Can, and they said the same to Sayyidina Suhaib. You came a little thing, so look, very poor. And from us, you had this business and you made the money from us. No, I didn't make the money from you. I made the money because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for me and I worked hard. For Sayyidina Suhaib Rumi, يعني, he wanted to migrate anyway. You know what happened? He gave them, يعني, long story short, he gave them everything. He left everything for them and he left to Mecca or to Medina. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, when he received them in Medina, he told them or he said to him, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَ. It's a very profitable transaction that you have done with the people of Quraysh. They look at them this way. Sayyidina Khabbab was one of those people. So he came to the Prophet ﷺ one day, يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم in his burda, his abaya next to Al-Kaaba, while we have had this hard time with the people of Quraysh, I came to the Prophet ﷺ and I said, Ya Rasulullah, make dua for us. يعني خلاص, it's hard. It's getting tough and hard on us. ادعو لنا. ألا تدعو لنا. ألا تستنصر لنا. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from those people. فقال مين اللي قال ذا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بيقول له إبال قد كان الرجل من قبلكم يؤخذ فيحفر له في الأرض فيجعل فيها ثم يؤتى بمنشار فيوضع على رأسه فيجعل نصفين ويمشط بأنشاط الحديد ما دون لحمه وعظمه ما يصده ذلك عن دينه. يعني the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم knows that this مرحلة, this stage of Islam needs men, needs people to sacrifice, people to give their life for the sake of Allah, people to sacrifice their joy and their entertainment to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He, don't you think that, we said it last week, when the things get very tight and hard on the Prophet ﷺ, and this is one of the hardest situations that the Prophet ﷺ went through, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Zaydna Jibreel along with the angel of mountains, right? It was only one word from the Prophet ﷺ to squeeze all those people between the two mountains, right? So you know, and we know for sure that the Prophet ﷺ was able to make the dua and his dua absolutely, absolutely acceptable. Because he made that dua against those seven people, something that we mentioned before too. He made dua against those seven people and his dua was acceptable sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he was able to do that, but he wanted to teach them. It's not that. You have to sacrifice, man. You want to raise up your kids in this country, and you want to raise them up Islamic way, you have to sacrifice a lot. If you're watching TV day and night in front of your kids, you're not doing anything. If you are using the same ways that you're not ready to bring your kids, sacrifice part of your sleep, and come to the masjid in the morning, in the evening, and attend the masjid and teach them, lead them by example, leading by example, you're not doing anything. You're not getting the goal. You have to sacrifice this. You have to do something. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling them, no, it's not that easy. You have to go through hardship. لَقَدْ كَانَ الرَّجُلُ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ People of the man in the umam that came before us used to be brought. They used to bring the man, put him in a big hole, throw him. ثُمَّ يُوضَعُ Imagine that this happened to somebody, that Munchar, that was saw, right? They put the saw on his head and they cut him in half. Like they cut him two halves or two parts. They cut that, you and me. And he never said, I disbelieve in my Iman or in my Lord. He's still on his religion. فَمَا يَصُدُّهُ ذَلِكَ This, even that situation doesn't take him from his religion. فما يصده ذلك عن دينه ويمشط بأمشاط الحديد ما بين عظمه وجلده. They used to get iron combs and they take the skin out. All of this. But by the way, and there is something relevant to that. We're not asking for this, by the way. Islam doesn't ask for this. If you don't have to go through this, don't go through it. Don't wish for it and have something about it. As I said in the beginning, inshallah, we're finishing soon. فيقول ثم يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ويعطي بشارة لنا جميعا والله ليتمن الله هذا الأمر حتى يسير الراكب من صنعاء. طب من صنعاء إلى ولا منين؟ إلى حضرموت. هيروح عند من صنعاء إلى حضرموت لا يخاف إلا الله والذئب على غنمه ولكن لكم تستعجلون. You don't have patience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will perfect this religion. It happened or not? It happened. But you're not patient. You want everything happens right away. No, you have to be patient. You have to learn from the seerah of those great people that followed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yeah, they have lots to say about this hadith, but there is a fa'idah, there is a lesson that has to be taken from this, which is, يعني, can a person, like some people, يعني, like, hey, they come to us. بتتكلم عن المنظر وسايب اللي بيحصل مش عارف فين وبيحصل فين وما بتقولش اللي بيحصل هنا وهنا. ما انا لو قلت حرف ورا الشمس مش هتشوفوني تاني. مع السلامة. فحتى this is not from the sunnah that you talk about something that gets you in trouble and you lose your existence at the end of the day and not doing anything. ولذلك يعني حتى في حديث بيقول كده, بيقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم okay. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لقى العدو. So basically don't wish for that. And if you are a public speaker, take it from me and this is from the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Do not just talk about everything. Maybe something you don't want to talk about it. To protect yourself, it's not haram to protect yourself. It's not haram to protect your family. It's not haram to protect your organization. Like some people, they don't pay attention. They just call the members and they say anything. Yeah, you know, it's not this. Not anywhere in the world. Say what benefits the community and stop saying what makes problems for you or the organization or anybody. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لقى العدو ذات يوم في بعض أيامه فانتظر حتى إذا مالت الشمس قام فخطب في أصحابه فقال أيها الناس لا تتمنوا لقاء العدو لا تتمنوا لقاء العدو وسلوا الله العافية فإذا لقيتموهم فاصبروا. يعني do not wish for that. Do not wish, do not put yourself in trouble intentionally. Do not wish for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he was going for a battle and then until the sun goes down and then he said to the, he gave khutbah to the people and he talked to the people saying, oh people, do not wish for meeting, for going to meet your enemy. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you. It's better. It's much better. But if you have to, you have to be here, man. So that's what happened with the Sahaba. They didn't put themselves in these things. They asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala العافيه, but they had to and they were men. ولذلك سيدنا ابو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه يقول انه قام يوما على المنبر ثم بكى ثم قال قام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عام اول على هذا المنبر ثم قال سال الله العافيه العفو والعافيه فما اعطي احد عطاء بعد اليقين خير من العافيه. يعني سيدنا ابو بكر الصديق when he went to the member and he started talking and crying and he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم last year he wasn't the same member saying, addressing and advising us to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for afu and afiya. What do you think the meaning of afu and afiya? Who can translate? Yeah. Afu and afiya. Sal Allah al afu wal afiya. Forgiveness and? Huh? مش عارفين afu يعني? Huh? Salaam. Salvation as you said. Protection for yourself and for your family. So you always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this, basically. But فَمَا أُعْطِيَ أَحَدٍ سيدنا أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه يقول that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the best thing that you ever get after yaqeen, after belief is this, that you're strong, you are يعني الحمد لله forgiven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you and He gives you that strength in your body and in your willingness and in your behavior as a Muslim. So don't ask for that. Don't ask for like, you know what, I want to be that like Sayyidina Bilal. I want to go through that. I will go to this person and you know what, I will go to the media and tell them you guys are, and you guys doing this and you guys whatever. And alhamdulillah, no, you're not brave, by the way. It's not shaja'ah. It's not something that we're looking for. I'm looking for somebody who will teach the people the religion, work harder on his community, the community gets stronger, all what we need. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did. He taught his people until they become stronger, and you guys will know what happened in Medina when they moved to Medina. So lots to say about this period, what happened to the Sahaba, lots of the Sahaba, they went through this. I got just few selections from what happened with the Sahaba and the Prophet ﷺ. Guess what happened after that? Now they tried torturing him, didn't work. In all ways, they tried to torturing the Sahaba, it didn't work. Now, they will go to him and negotiate. Give you this, he give us this. You know what? What happened in this stage, in this period? What are the negotiations that happened between the Prophet ﷺ and the people of Quraysh? And what was the answer and the response of the Prophet ﷺ to all of this? Inshallah ta'ala, that will be the topic for next week, inshallah, this year. I'll see you guys all, inshallah, tomorrow for the fifth class. أسأل الله عز وجل أن يعلمنا ما ينفعنا وأن ينفعنا بما علمنا فهو ولي ذلك والقدر عليه. جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم.